Cant or Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Grounded, a fierce feminine guide to connecting to the soil and healing from the ground up by Erin Yu Juin McMorrow, PhD, narrated by Tiffany Morgan. Let the beauty we love be what we do. There are hundreds of ways to kneel and kiss the ground. Rumi. Are you afraid of the void? The fertile soil? The fertile soul? Where seeds come to life? Crack open, fight for light. In darkness we grow, from the void we emerge. New moon, bloody flow, where'd she go? Welcome to the collective blind spot, the collective wound, death, release, decomposition, rebirth. She is the garden, there is no exile. She simply holds space for us to finally face the eternal truth. How could this be? What can't we see? Cycles unbroken, simply imbalanced, return again and again. Connect the dots, my lovers and friends. The wound only heals when we face in. The humble worm, eight-legged goddess, infinity creatrix, night sky, everlasting. There's only one way home. Turn in, tune in. Yin, yang, up, down, in, out. Breath reveals. Holy love heals. Follow the drumbeat. Look toward the light. Bow to the night. The portal, the vortex, the mother, the spiral, the beat, the virgin woman under herself. Sexual healing, that's what I said. As above, so below. What are we pretending we don't know? Welcome the muse of creation and transformation, priestesses of transmutation, goddesses of liberation. Bow to the great mother. Remember, the soil, stuff of stars, the humble answer, rebirthing the only truth there ever was. Introduction. Take three breaths. Allow the skin of the old to shed away and welcome the possibility of what's to come. We are rebirthing ourselves and midwifing a new era, a new world, a new vision. Walk with me into a world of possibility, alignment, love, and truth. The root of the climate crisis is the invitation to heal our individual and collective root chakra, as it was first known in the Hindu tantric traditions, although our ancient connection to the earth is universal. Our root is our base, foundation, home, identity, innate power, release, safety, security, structure, and connection to the earth. Humanity teeters at the edge of extinction because for too long we have been too afraid to remember, to come home, to turn inward. For thousands of years, we have been handing over our power to institutions, ideas, and individuals outside of ourselves. For way too long, we've bought into the story that we can somehow derive our power from external things, social status, relationships, property, objects, titles, degrees, even talents and knowledge. We've believed that nature herself is dangerous, our enemy, and that she is meant to be tamed, mined, and owned. We've bowed to a single male god in the sky and lashed out at the notion of an embodied spiritual truth that incorporates the balance of the sacred feminine and sacred masculine in the grand harmony of all things within us. The feminine and masculine energies are not specific to gender. They are part of each of us. We are working with the dance between steady structure and fluid receiving energy, the calm protector and initiator of the masculine and the flowing, adaptable, womb-like creative nature of the feminine. As we find balance within ourselves, we become better able to create balance in our outer worlds. Reconnecting with our lower chakras also reconnects us to our roots, the story of the earth, the great mother, and our own creative life force energy. We remember that we are part of the grand dance of all things. Climate catastrophe, biodiversity loss, the sixth mass extinction, ocean acidification, desertification, and runoff and dead zones in the oceans are all connected to the same thing: the killing of microscopic life in the soil. Our disconnection from the soil is our disconnection from the fertile feminine. By killing this life en masse, we are profoundly disrupting the carbon cycle along with all the cycles of nature. While the entire movement of regenerative agriculture, a form of agriculture that focuses on improving soil health, has made significant headway with this message in the climate conversation, the memo has yet to go mainstream. Most of us have never heard of soil's critical connection to the climate emergency. Even fewer of us are aware of the profound spiritual connections among the earth, climate, and the interrelatedness of all things. Understanding ourselves as a part of nature, as opposed to as separate entities who affect nature, is fundamental to this larger view. Further, the connection between empowering women and girls and turning the tide on the climate emergency is clear. Access to education and reproductive rights are at the heart of the dire situation we have collectively created. Catherine Wilkinson of Project Drawdown highlights the role of women in food production on small lots, describing how that work ties in with protection of forests, as well as how reproductive education and rights have as much or more of an impact on our collective climate footprint as renewable energy. Wilkinson urges us to be messengers, hearts broken open in this journey. Protecting our forests, getting into right relationship with animals, plants, and fungi, healing our food systems, and freeing and protecting women and girls from poverty, genital mutilation, sexual assault and harassment, and sex trafficking are all mission critical to creating human systems aligned with Mother Nature. The only way to return to balance is to heal the Earth Mother and our collective root chakra, as well as our own individual roots, and to harmonize the feminine and masculine energies within ourselves. This also means simultaneously working to heal the soil, supporting indigenous peoples and lands, and advocating for women and girls around the world. As above, so below. The macro reflects the micro and vice versa. You may already know that soil is one of the most important things in the world when it comes to human survival, right up there with water and oxygen. But likely you have little idea of what that means on a practical level or what to do about it. It's actually incredibly simple, and we already have everything we need to shift our systems on Earth. All we need is to remember, align, and act. As we heal our connection to the soil, we move toward healing our bodies, the earth, and our spirits. Life is a miracle. Microscopic processes inside the cells of plants convert sunlight into energy that we humans in turn can use. Not only use, but need for survival. Pause there for a moment. Take a breath. Wow. The only way to understand the world of the small things that make all life on Earth possible is to trace back to the first life, our friends, the single-celled organisms. Microscopic life was the first on Earth, and nobody knows for sure how it came to be. Our best guesses involve comets or curious vibrations in the primordial soup. So, basically, magic, God, aliens, or something. The divine mysteries, spirit, life on Earth, body, and our evolutionary history, science, have everything to do with soil health and climate change. It's all connected, and the only way to solve the problem is to take it all in, magic included. I'm not talking about the kind of delusional magical thinking we've been engaged in as a species thus far. I'm talking about real magic. Mysteries of life and creativity magic. If we follow the thread from the primordial soup and through our basic cellular evolution, we can make our way to the present-day carbon cycle and everything that's wrong with it. We can do better by healing the soil, healing ourselves, and healing our relationship with the Great Mother and all that is. The soil is alive. All nature is connected, and we are profoundly connected to the soil and each other. Carbon is the building block of life. If we manage to figure this out and act on it in short order, we can avoid running ourselves into extinction. Healing the soil by repairing the microscopic life we've been killing, healing with indigenous peoples and lands, and uplifting women and girls are the most important things we can do to repair vital earth systems right now. This is healing the sacred and the feminine. The good news is, if you have the luxury to listen to this, you are someone who can do something about it. Tuning in to the cycles of nature and becoming aware of what makes both the earth and our bodies tick can help us understand what life is all about. Sustainability is about the sacred connections with all of life. We are souls having a human experience. We are embodied, and we are physically made of the same stuff as everything else. We are in some form of symbiosis with everything that lives and in direct symbiosis with soil life, which we have been killing for some time now with our ignorance, unconsciousness, and disconnectedness. By killing life in the soil, we are essentially killing ourselves, and it will take reconnecting and recultivating life where it is currently being harmed underground to right the balance. By reconnecting and healing the soil, we honor the life within us all, from dead zones in the ocean to clean drinking water to the amount of nutrients and the very food we eat to how we care for ourselves and each other. This is the story of everything. Crossing the threshold we currently face will require the courage to turn inward into the darkness, into the lies, and into the shadowy untruths that have defined humanity for thousands of years. It will require us to tune in to our deepest knowing, our bodies, and our own collective shadow to discover the truth that is ever-present and always underfoot. The truth of the suppressed divine feminine in harmony with the suppressed divine masculine. When we choose in, when we choose to face the fire and go directly into our suppressed pain, we'll find freedom on the other side, as long as we support each other through the process. Ultimately, we'll find our earthly survival and cultivate our path to thriving through Mother Nature, the Mother Goddess, Pachamama, Gaia, the fertile soil, the divine feminine. She houses the seed, life gestates in the dark, new life is born, and eventually it returns back to the mother. We have forgotten that we belong to the land, not the other way around. We get to remember that while we are healing her, she is healing us. I'm pointing straight at the most important Western cultural, societal, and psychological blind spot. The great Earth Mother Goddess is feminine sexuality and the sexuality of nature. She is the void, death, birth, grief, and fertility. She is the birth-giving, life-giving, magic-making creatrix, the night sky and the moon, the divine order of chaos. The lunar seed metaphor represents the cycles of nature, the harvest, the seasons, and menstruation, gestation, birth, life, death, and rebirth. She cannot be owned. We belong to the land, and we belong to ourselves. The fertile, living soil is the collective blind spot, and our blindness is killing us. This book is a direct shot at opening the third eye of patriarchy. I learned an incredibly important thing from the field of urban planning. A non-decision is a de facto decision. Illustrated in excruciating clarity by the federal COVID-19 response in the United States. Outcomes will arise from either acting or not acting, and in this case, either action or inaction will have major effects. If we do not act, the amount of carbon in the atmosphere and the oceans will continue to rise, while the amount in the soils will continue to fall, to the lasting detriment of the soils, which means to ourselves. The good news is that there is something we can actually do about it. If we choose to, we can build a world and the systems we desire with our own hands. We can get to work, do what it takes to potentially save ourselves, and create something regenerative, harmonious, and beautiful for the future. Summoning the courage to take on this work will require that we look the problems at hand directly in the eye. Connecting the dots. This personal journey has been divinely guided, and this book is my offering. I entered this path upside down and backwards, and have been birthed and rebirthed along the way. Originally, in an effort to wake up humanity to both the dire state of current conditions and to what might be possible, I began with the intention of laying out a scientific argument about soil health and climate change. Much to my amusement now, I had no idea what I actually signed up for. After years of spiritual journeying, I have finally landed at the feet of the great Earth Mother, the Creatrix, the Dark Goddess. This journey continues to guide me through the lands of the suppressed and oppressed, indigenous ways of knowing, storytelling, shamanism, feminism, witches, ceremony, divination, sacred sexuality, the oppression of women and girls, and plant medicine. I explore several of these in this book, although I focus more on the role of the soil in our climate emergency, as well as the role of inner work within individual soul recovery. The voice of the divine feminine, the bringer of life and the overseer of death and rebirth, has guided my hand at each turn. And in each personal rebirth and soul retrieval of my own, the eternal message remains the same. Everything is interconnected. The universe is alive, benevolent, and co-creative, and nature is always speaking to us as we are part of her. My job in this moment, as part of the collective ecosystem, is to firmly and boldly anchor the truth wherever I stand. Humanity is moving through a metamorphic awakening of consciousness, and teams of light bearers are assembling to help guide the process. As we pass into this collective rebirth, we also move through a collective death. Patriarchal systems and ways of being are crumbling and collapsing all around us, and what has been built atop centuries of lies can no longer stand. Without the structural integrity of a healthy root system, our castles are built on sand. The resonant voice of nature herself and all of us as a part of her is rising up in love. And the force is unstoppable. Consciousness itself is being reborn as the universe continues to align, breathe, recognize, and make love with itself. The rebalancing of the sacred feminine and sacred masculine energies is inevitable, and it's happening all around us as the natural alignment of the universe brings humans into balance with the greater whole. This book is a guidebook, a lighthouse, and a flagpost to help you navigate and orient yourself in the changing tides. I specifically intend to simplify the complex and help connect the dots among the soil, the climate, the divine feminine, the goddess, and the healing of women and girls on this earth. The way forward requires our own personal work, meeting that inner work with outer work in the world, and understanding that all of this is interdependently connected. We can't truly connect with ourselves without understanding how we're connected with each other and everything around us, physically, with our breath, the food we eat, and the constant turnover of our cells. And we are all energetically connected through the great web of life, death, and rebirth. We've always known this as humans. We've merely forgotten. This book is about remembering who we are. Remembering we are one, with each other, with the earth, and with the divine. This truth has been rewritten, co-opted, obscured, and cast aside. Navigating our way back actually requires us to face our fears directly and integrate them, and to approach those fears as exiled parts of ourselves. We are infinitely, intimately interconnected, inherently in balance with all there is and all there ever was. What we call the beginning is often the end, and to make an end is to make a beginning. The end is where we start from. T.S. Eliot. My journey. Before we get into the brass tacks, I want to share some of my personal journey with you. I'm not here to tell you how it is. I'm a messenger, and I'm here to share what I've discovered. When I embarked upon this journey years ago, I had no idea that the soil is the oldest divine feminine metaphor of all time. Neither did I know much about life in the soil, and, in fact, I probably knew zero about its relationship to climate change, even with a PhD in urban planning. My process has been an unveiling and unraveling, as well as a sincere surrender. When we say yes to spirit, we often end up drinking from the fire hose of new information and associations, in my case, for more than 7 years, which is both an eternity and the blink of an eye. Everything about this was considered wacky when I started. Over these years, the wheel has been turning, and the peers in the regenerative agricultural movement have brought the story of the soil from relative obscurity to front and center in the climate conversation. Simultaneously, colleagues have been recovering, piecing together, and sharing ancient wisdom about goddess history, the divine feminine and masculine, and plant medicine, and have offered the healing experiential aspect of this story far more deeply into the mainstream. When I began this journey, these worlds were seemingly disparate and incompatible. I struggled profoundly with society's insistence that I fit in a box somewhere recognizable to others. Spiritual growth is bumpy, beautiful, confronting, hilarious, and always humbling. Coming out of the woo closet has been my most challenging obstacle and my greatest opportunity. The bumps and triumphs in my path have been many. My first faceplant came in 2013, heading toward what I now recognize as a classic spiritual breakdown, right after I graduated with my doctorate. I really thought I had my life figured out at the time. I had been writing like a madwoman for months, with a ferocity that I've only recently matched since. I completed my dissertation, defended it, and celebrated. My family flew in from all over, my dad opened the good wine, and we had a rager. Utterly exhausted, I dropped off my last guest, my mom, at LAX and then came home to find out that the awesome house I'd been leasing was going up for sale. To top it off, I'd almost spent what was left of my dissertation fellowship. There it went. 6 years of structure and purpose, all of my income, and my house. I had no plan whatsoever. Fortunately, I'm a seasoned budget traveler and a little bit of a hustler, so I was able to string together some odd jobs and rented out my own home for survival for a few months as I threw myself into the job search. I knew it would all come together. I had a PhD for crying out loud, and there was opportunity everywhere. A friend of mine named Chance, yes, that's his real name, said, "There's this volunteer group I think you'd love. It's about how healing soil solves all these sustainability problems, and we're building an urban garden in Venice, California." I can't remember specifically what he said, but what I do remember is that as he was speaking, I saw it all click into place. I started attending the volunteer group meetings and stayed quiet. Every week, a group of us gathered in my friend Ryland's living room to discuss strategies and next steps. The group had been meeting for a few months already. The host family had founded a wildly popular vegan restaurant in California, and so he was looped into the local organic food scene. He had heard soil consultant Graham Sayed speak at a conference in Australia, and it had propelled him on a mission to spread the word, because Graham had been the only speaker to offer solutions, whereas the others just went on and on about the doom and gloom state of the earth. I listened quietly at first to the discussions about compost and crowdfunding and building an urban garden. I did what I could to contribute my time and expertise while still looking for a job and moving. Those first few months were madcap. We built a garden from scratch and threw a launch party, only to have the garden promptly torn down by the landowner who wanted to put a giant condo there. We had heated conversations about becoming an organization and raising money. Would we be a business, a B Corp, or a nonprofit? And for God's sake, what was our mission? To educate? Tell the story? Plant gardens? We storyboarded and began a crowdfunding campaign. Then we invited Graham to town for a big party. Someone asked him the obvious question, "What should we focus on?" He replied, "City-level policy. We need to get cities composting." When I brought up my policy experience and knowledge, Graham asked, "Will you be going to the mayor's office with us?" I hadn't, until that point, been invited. Until then, I had been lying low and suddenly found myself in the middle of the process. We went, and it was exciting to share the story of the soil with city officials, but it was just a speck in what would eventually come to be. From there, we thrashed onward, fueled by passion and rowdy idealism, I became the first director of the group and threw everything I had into it. I was already used to not making a lot of money, and my primary focus was getting my hands on something aimed at making a significant difference. I spent countless hours on the phone and at our meetings trying to chart a course for a group of volunteers to transform us into a functional, funded organization. We had absolutely no idea what we were doing, but I've never seen such a committed group of people. They donated untold hours of their lives for a cause, driven by the genuine belief that our broken relationship with soil is the problem, the story, and the call to action of our generation. After an enormously long and ridiculous search for identity, we secured a seed grant and a lawyer and started down the road to becoming a 501c3 nonprofit organization we named Kiss the Ground. We began work on The Soil Story, an animated film that describes soil's relationship to climate, humans, and the ecosystem at large. At that point, I had to take a break. I had been cracking for a while, barely scraping by and forced to move yet again. The startup process of building something out of nothing had been extremely hard on my heart, too, and I felt ravaged after the jolts of graduation, two displacements, and a variety of other losses along the way. By 2014, it was time for a change. I decided to put all my stuff into storage, fly to Indonesia for yoga teacher training, slow down, and get some clarity. I knew that my whole soul was called to work on this issue, but I was no longer meant to be in the center of Kiss the Ground. I had imagined that the well-paying post-PhD dream job that I was certain to acquire would have arrived by then, and it hadn't. I had suppressed my desire to pursue yoga teacher training because until that point, it felt like anything other than chasing after my dream job was irresponsible. As I was pondering my next move, a childhood friend suddenly passed away of a fast-moving cancer. She was my age, with two small children and a husband. I realized that I'd regret not going to Bali if it were me finding out I was going to die. It was a giant leap that went against everything I was raised to believe was a good, responsible decision. Interestingly enough, this book started to come through me on the plane to Bali. The experience was utterly transformative and easily one of the best decisions I've ever made. I entered the worlds of personal and spiritual healing modalities, working with subtle energies and the mind-body-spirit connection. It's here that I came to learn about the chakras, found my feet, and began to shed the layers of false societal conditioning around my inner power and worthiness as a spiritual being. I picked up the scent of my wildness, my connection to nature, and started to follow it with increasing trust. I committed my life to this shift and began teaching yoga and doing healing work, as well as writing my book and building my business when I returned. I reunited with the Kiss the Ground crew in Paris at the COP21 climate talks in December 2015 after working on this book for about a year and a half. We were together to see the words, "The Soil Story," go up in lights on the Eiffel Tower. After all of the intense growing pains and stumbles we had experienced in our parallel journeys driven by the same fire, it was profoundly healing for me and the rest of the crew, I think. The organization was blossoming, and the regenerative agricultural movement was growing. Paris, all told, was a life-changing experience and a heartwarming success for us soil people, especially when the French agricultural minister proposed a program called 4 per 1,000, despite it not making the mainstream news. The initiative calls for countries to increase carbon in soils by 0.4%, which, if done worldwide, could halt the annual increase in CO2 in the atmosphere. Dozens of countries and organizations signed on. Stop for a moment and imagine the possibility. At the same time, I was becoming a writer, an artist, and an activist. I wrote and published a 400-word version of this story with Upworthy, which had tens of thousands of likes and views in the first week. The article was even promoted by Michael Pollan, a sizable victory for me at that juncture in my career. I met more soil allies on the ground, community group members, authors, researchers, and activists who had crossed the planet to fight for healthy soil. I learned more about how hard Indigenous groups, some of the most violated people around the world, were fighting on their home turf against climate change and its causes. I would be told for the next 5 years that climate change doesn't sell with regard to books and articles. But a foundation had been laid in my spirit, and inevitably the cultural zeitgeist would shift back toward climate awareness and action. The spiritual and the practical were indeed weaving within the collective and me, but the impact of it all would only become clear in retrospect. I also had the honor of attending the Pathway to Paris concert, where Thom Yorke's voice blew a hole in my heart and inspired a resonance that will be with me forever. He sang Silent Spring, among other songs. Patti Smith was there too, and her cover of Lennon's Imagine absolutely destroyed my friend and me, leaving us weeping in a puddle. Side note, John Lennon had been assassinated.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.